I'm Vijay from Think Future Technologies. I'm co-founder and CEO. Tushar, my colleague, is senior project manager with the company. And we're representing a framework that we have developed. So essentially, we are an outsourcing company. We provide services to our clients in testing, QA testing, automation testing, performance testing area. And so our clients come with a various kind of usage of various test case management tools and various kinds of test automation tools. To give an example, some people use Query Center with QDP. Some of them use Microsoft Test Manager with Coded UI, or Selenium with TestLink or something like that, right? Or Brumin. So we had a need to integrate all this and to be able to provide service in a uniform way to our clients. So I'll just give a brief about what our company is, Think Future Technologies. So that's our company, based in India, near the capital. We're around 150 plus employees, and these are some of the certificates. We are CMA Level 3 and Microsoft Gold Certified. This is essentially what we do. 70% of our work is in QA and testing. And besides that, some pieces in software development and maintenance and support. So without much ado, we'll just move into QA and what all we do in QA. So that's our entire spectrum of what we handle in QA and testing. So including manual testing, functional testing, and then the test automation, building the suit, maintaining it, running it, API testing, performance testing. And then we come to TAGS. TAGS stands for TFT Automation Framework for Generic System. This is an overview of what I'll be covering in this presentation. So we'll have a presentation followed by a demonstration. Tushar will be giving a live demonstration of how we run the test suite. So this is essentially what TAGS is. It's a tool which allows a QA engineer to write test cases in spreadsheet. So usage of spreadsheets. It allows a QA engineer to define object repository in a spreadsheet. It allows a QA engineer to define the test data or modify the test data at runtime using spreadsheets. And essentially, we integrate various test management tools at this end. So it could be XStudio, for instance, comes by default built into TAGS, or you could have a Query Center or Test Manager. The test cases are downloaded from the test case from the test case management tool. And the test engine, the TAG, which is the TAGS engine, takes over, performs each step action, passes it to the relevant automation tool. So it's Selenium, it'll pass to Selenium. If it's QDP, it'll pass it to QDP. Gets the result back and stores the result back into the test case management tool. So these are some of the benefits. Like, because the object repository is separated from the main execution, it's easy to maintain. Like yesterday there was a presentation on how a developer, when he makes a modification to an object definition, should regenerate the object definition in a page. So that's a very easy way to do it. You have additional features like you want to tie into a database and get the values and check at the runtime. So that's something you can do. You could do A/B testing. And right now we are partnered with Sauce Labs, and we have clients who use TAGS to execute their test suite on a cloud. This is a roadmap and where we are right now. So we have just released version 2.0 in January. And these are the various support that we do right now. So obviously we provide support for Selenium WebDriver. We do not use Selenium grid, we use our own grid, TAG grid, to drive distributed execution of the test suites on various machines. We obviously do browser automation. Then we can also do remote execution. So it could be a server client kind of interaction. API automation. Then obviously we are tying up with various test case management tools. And these are some other things that you would want to go through. Notably, we are doing mobile app automation for SDK-based apps on Android. We also done it for iPhone, but there's a problem because iPhone requires a build to be changed on the fly. And these are some of the upcoming features in tags. I'll show you, essentially there are three components of the solution. One is called a test case sheet, the other is a test data sheet, and third is an object repository. So essentially what we're doing is we have a row in the spreadsheet which is like a test step in a test case. And what it does is, because we have abstracted out the object repository, we have abstracted out the data, it refers to the appropriate spreadsheets to drive each test case. I'll just show you a sample. So essentially what this slide shows is that there are three, that's the one which drives a test case execution. It picks up the object repository from here, and then picks up the test data from there and executes it. So down the road, if there's a change in object definition, you just need to go and make a change in this spreadsheet. Your test case remains as it is. That's again a kind of a interface architecture where you have this tagged interface layer. It pulls in object repository, test cases, test data, fires it to the engine, which in turn fires it to the automation tool, and the results come back over here and goes to the appropriate test case management tool. Currently we have implementation for RackStudio, Quality Center, and Microsoft Test Manager. And on this side, we have implementation of Selenium and QDP. Test complete is partially there, it's not complete yet. This is an example of a tag grid, which allows us to have one controller, a web-based controller, which can drive various VMs on the fly. So for instance, we have a client, Match.com, which has a suite of around 3,000 test cases. So we execute them parallelly on 10 VMs. So some of the advantages of using this kind of framework is obviously a lot of Q engineers are very used to the spreadsheet format, being able to, I mean, that's how they write the manual test cases. So for them, it's a little bit of incremental learning, not too much of a different, I mean, they don't need to really step up and learn a new thing. It's an easy integration with test case management tool and test automation layer because we have abstracted out the functions, the keyword-driven functions that need to be implemented using the automation API. The object repository is abstracted out. It's defined in a simple way. So it could be modified both by a developer or a Q engineer. Then we allow hooks to do backend validation. So some of the things you just cannot do using the front end, you need to go to the database, talk to it, get the values, and see if something has happened or not. With the increased user mobile, obviously the direction we're moving into is providing services. So we allow you to do, we allow an easy way to do the API testing. Again, driven through spreadsheets. We have introduced the concept of variable, which allows us to do A/B testing. So I'll show an example where you could set a variable, and then the test case doesn't need to change. It'll automatically pick up the values you need to do for the A/B testing. So these are some of the clients. I'll just show you the spreadsheet, and then I'll request Tushar to go over the demo. So all of these clients, Match, American Greetings, IncrediMail, Shutterstock, AG Interactive, they all are using our automation, Bond University. So this is the entire structure of our solution, tag solution. And if you notice, this object repository, test cases, and test data, These are the three important directories that you need to concentrate on. What we do is we define when we start off. So this is right now built using C# or DLL. We have a project which we are rewriting this to Java. So this parameters.ini is what controls your execution. So for instance, if I want to do from a browser Firefox, then you choose that. You can choose IE, Safari, or Chrome.
Can you change browser
to
fly, or do you have to modify the
interface? Yeah, so you need to modify it, one, and then you start off. So you cannot do it on the fly.
I mean, once it completes one test, after that, you can just go into the parameter.ini, change the browser, and then it will execute on that particular.
But you could do it from the grid. For instance, if you want to drive it using a web-based interface, so you could choose the browser there and drive it from there. And so here you could control the location of your test cases, location of your test data. You could control where your recovery scenarios are based in. So the date format, the test suite name which you want to run, the time format, if you want to connect to a database, the connection string for the database is here. If you want to do, you want to capture screens, you want to do a debug, you want to send emails to where the email should be sent if there's a problem, or if you want to send the results to an email, that you can do. So those controls are built into this parameters.ini. Let me show you the test case. So this is a spreadsheet which has these test cases, and they're organized along page objects. So you have a particular test case, and you have the steps. Each of these steps, so let me go over the columns first. So you have a test scenario name, you have a test case ID, second column. You have a parent, the parent represents the, it could be like if you're doing a Windows desktop automation, it could be the name of the window or the parent. You have the logical name of the test object, and then you have the test action. Data contains the actual data, for instance. So there are two ways to do the data. You could have data extracted out into a spreadsheet, or you could drive the data from here. So in cases where there's single data, you may want to put it here. Or if something needs to be iterated, for example, here you have iteration count. So for instance, if you want to have 10 different username passwords to be tested, you could actually extract that data into a spreadsheet and have them in row number 1 to 10. And here you could say just 1-10. So what that would mean is from the test data sheet, it's going to pick up the test data from rows 1 to 10 and iterate over it. So for example, if I were to look at this particular step action, these would be defined in what are called the page methods. So for instance, if you look at a launch demo app is basically open browser. And similarly, we say click registration, let's look at this, do registration. So do registration would be this method here, and these are the steps over here. So you would, for instance, you will have, this is object repository name. So what it says is, pick this particular object, do this step action, which is enter unique data. And this data is based on the step action. So here it means whatever number you enter, name you enter should be of length 8. So for example here, when you're saying enter data into that particular edit last name, this is the data, which is name of the person, last name. Here you have a concept of a variable. So when you say dollar mobile number, so whatever number gets entered, that gets saved into this dollar mobile number. So you could use that mobile number later on. Yes, so we have a drop-down list, and actually we have a list of reusable functions. So people use, I mean, reusable function, their parameters, expected parameters. So we use that. I don't think we have put it as a macro. One of the projects that we have is putting that here as a macro. So
he,
yes. We have about 120 step actions.
120 step actions, and these are basically the Selenium actions which you write. And then on the top of it, we have also made some custom actions.
So, I mean, these actions are in turn interpreted using Selenium API. So let's say click will be, you know, based on whether it's a Selenium driver, would move to the click of Selenium. And let me show the object repository. So this is object repository. So for instance, if you're looking at first name, so I mean, this object repository large because this is representing multiple demos, but so this combination of parent and the test object name is what is unique. And this is a logical name. This actually is a text box with a CSS locator with input type HTML name equal to first name. So it's going to look at the name property of the input type of HTML object with ID with name equal to first name. So tomorrow, if you want to change, for instance, the developer changes it to a text area, then you will need to make a change over here. You will just come and make a change over here, saying that this is a text area, and then over here, saying that it's a text area. Or if you want to change the ID, we'll go and make a change here. Since you're a first name, it's F name, so that's what it'll become. So you're making change in the object repository file, the test cases remain as they are. And the value here is the developers and QA guys, they could be sharing this object repository. And before at any point when developers make a change, they could actually be looking at this and more updating it. The results, so once this executes, this test case completes, the results get stored away in a results folder here. We're going to show you how it works. Tushar is going to show exactly how it works. But basically, the results come here as XML. And then we have a result formatter which picks up the XML and modifies it and presents you with a HTML report. So if you have this XML, let's go and look at the HTML. So instead, if I look at this report, so this is the steps which failed, machine name and all, and you could open that. You could see which step failed, what are the reason for failure. You could also have a screen dump with it, and you could look at the screen dump. So for instance, this is example of a pass test cases. And we also provide appropriate comments whenever we feel that something is taking more time than required. So you can see in comment, time spent for this is so much, so which means there's some problem. Okay, with this, I'll ask Tushar to give you a demo, and then we can answer any questions at the end of it. Are you using your laptop? Okay.
Thank you, Vijay. Okay, so one of the benefits why we moved over to this particular framework was, if a team size is small, if you have one or two testers, they could be tech savvy. But we have certain clients who need like 8 or 9 or 10 automation engineers, and it becomes very difficult for us to find resources as well as to manage the code. Like if each one of them is writing a code, then it becomes very difficult to review the code as well. So with spreadsheets, we get rid of complete coding. You don't need to do any coding at all. What a tester needs is he just needs to create an object repository, which is common for the complete project. And that object repository is using CSS, XPath, whatever the Selenium recognizes. And then object repository is common to the whole project, and then we have a fixed format for writing test cases, as Vijay pointed out. You can go over to the test case ID, which is unique, and then you write the step actions, which is, again, we have a reference file from which you can see what all step actions are available, and then just go to the object repository and see whether that particular object is present. If not, make an entry so that other testers can use it as well. The prerequisite for tags to run on a particular machine is that you need to have Java runtime installed on your machine. It can run on a standalone server or a standalone machine. It can run on a server or a standalone machine. So let me quickly go over to. So this is how the folder structure looks like. As Vijay showed earlier, that parameter.ini is what drives it. So you can write down, you can change the browser from parameter.ini. You can select the directory where you want to store your results. You can select the directory from where you want to pick up the test cases. So let me quickly go over to the parameter.ini. Now, we have also integrated our solution with various tools. We have integrated with Quality Center, with the XStudio, with the Microsoft Test Manager. Right now, we are not using any test management tool. That's why we have to go over to these flat files, like a parameter.ini, and then go over to the tags.exe to execute the test cases. But if you have integration with the test management tool, like XStudio, which is an open source tool with which we are, again, partners. So if you go over to that particular tool, it's just a click of a button to execute it, rather than going over to all these parameter.ini file. So if I go to the parameter.ini file, so here, if you could see that browser is Firefox. Now, our solution supports both Selenium 1 as well as Selenium 2. So Selenium, based on the particular browser, we have Chrome, Safari, Firefox. We have even support for Opera. So based on a particular browser, it is going to select either Selenium 1 or Selenium 2. So this is where you define your browsers and all other parameters. Now, for this demo purposes, I would point out to the test suite name, which is demo auth. So our complete Excel file, if I go to the test cases folder. So in parameter.ini, I have selected this test cases folder is the path from where I'm going to pick up my test cases. So this demo auth is the name of an Excel file. When I put it as test suite, now demo auth may have two or three or maybe more test cases. So those are part of the whole suite. So we read one Excel file as one suite, and then in that suite, we may have multiple test cases present. So if I open this up, so another advantage of this framework is that you can reuse test cases. So if you see the test case demo.registration.252, it's giving a call to application.launch.demo.app, which is another test case within this particular folder. If I go over to the
chain test cases.
Pardon me? Yeah. So what you do is you maintain certain common test cases which are going to be reused in your whole project. So you can give a call from one Excel file to that particular test case. So when I go to this, you have this particular demo app.registration. It will talk about the parent. Parent could be name of a particular module or a page. So this is how you recognize whether I have, a tester will recognize whether I have objects present for this particular page. So page is referring to that particular module or a page. And then test object refers to the object present in the object repository. And step action is where it's going for the Selenium actions or the actions we have specified, like enter data. Mobile number is where it's going to be putting up an random numbers. So one of the problems which we face when you use Selenium IDE or record and play is that you need to give fixed numbers as input, and we need to save that number somewhere. So if I am putting up a random number, then I can save it as a variable and reuse it again within the test case. So here I'm defining all the steps. So once I have my test cases ready, of course, the first point is that I need to have objects present in the object repository. Only then it's going to recognize my test steps. So object repository, again, is an Excel file which is common for the whole project. now you're able to see multiple versions because we have multiple versions for different clients. So this is how an object repository looks like. You can put up properties of the objects with ID, name, CSS, or XPath. So once you have your object repository ready, once you have your test cases ready, next is you go over to the parameter.ini, specify the browser on which particular browser you want to execute your test case. Right now, I have set it up as Firefox. Then you simply go into the exe and then run the executable, which is our tags.exe. And it opens up a console window where for each step action, it's going to display what's happening. And then it will open up the browser, start executing the test cases. So whatever it's entering right now, like GN, my, the first name, it can store it as a variable which could be reused later on in your test case.
What's this driving at the moment?
Pardon me?
Which backend? What are you using to drive that test? Selenium
2? Selenium 2, yes. I mean, a user doesn't really know because the transition is seamless. You won't know whether it's Selenium 1 or 2.
Okay.
And once for in the parameter.ini, you can even specify whether you want to take snapshots on each step or you want to take snapshots on a failure. And if, let's suppose, you have a particular number of failures, whether you want to exit out of the test case or whether you want to continue executing it. So once it goes through the complete test case, it will exit out of it. Pardon me? I'm sorry, I'm not getting
it.
That's not web driver because you just modified disabled fields.
No.
Disabled fields.
No, this is Selenium Web Driver.
Disabled fields. That's, I think Yahoo shows you that gray text. So that you can see that what you need to enter there.
So once it completes running the test, then.
Can you see the Selenium? Yeah, there is Selenium WebDriver.
Yeah. This is the one which we are using.
This is the backup, but I think that the
original
one
is right. So
yeah.
That's the WebDriver, that's
the backup. And then once it executes the test cases wherever you have specified to store the results, it stores the results over there. We even send emails as soon as the test completes. We send out emails with the report attached. The reports look somehow like this. And on failure, since I had the option checked in, this is an earlier report which I had received. So on failure, if I need snapshots, then I can just click on that and I'll get the snapshot. And then I can even go for the HTML. It will give me HTML of that screen, of that particular step. It's opening right now. So this is the complete end-to-end. If you are executing a test suite where I had two test cases, I can even specify if I want to execute only one test case from an Excel file. So I can run either single test case or a test suite. So this is when you are executing on one particular machine. Now we have also created a grid. Maybe I can show you how the grid looks like. So the grid which we have created, you can execute multiple test cases in parallel on multiple machines. So this is how the grid looks like. It's again on Excel. On this parameter sheet, you can specify which particular machine you want to run as the controller. So what we have is we have a centralized controller, and then we have multiple agents running on different machines. So you will specify where your executable is, where your test suite location is, the username and password for this particular controller, what all different browsers will be supported, and then what kind of log will be generated, as well as your different test environments. Test environments are specified in your host file. Here you are specifying where our test environments are. And these are all the machines which are available. Now, batches is where it will show me all the suites which are available. So if I have to run a build verification test or a particular suite for execution, I have 100 or 200 test cases in 3 or 4 Excel files. I want to combine those Excel files into a batch. I can do that using another utility which we have. Once I create a batch, it will show up if wherever I would have specified, like if you go to parameter, I would have specified where my batch is. So it will pick up from that, and then you can change the settings, whether you want to execute this batch on a particular environment, which particular browser, and then whether you want to execute that batch on all machines. So if you execute a batch on all machines, then it is going to do load balancing as well. Like it will give, if I have 100 test cases I want to execute on 5 different machines, it will give test cases to each machine, and whichever becomes available, then it will distribute the test cases again to that particular machine. And then once you click on Get Automation Status, it will give you the status of each machine, whether one is idle, one is available, so it will give you the status as well. And once execution is done, it will generate a consolidated report, like the one which I showed you, the HTML report. And based on that, it's going to send it over to the email to the concerned person. Like you can set up whom you want to send emails to in the parameter.ini, and you'll receive the emails. So this is basically what we have. Any question?
Can you go back to that? Change
it to maybe IE?
Can you just show me the folder? I'm showing the driver view. Just click on W, web driver. Explore. Yeah. It's W. So that's a deal using web driver or deal. In certain cases, you know, when you move from Selenium 1 to Selenium 2, there are problems with some of the Selenium 2 functions. So in those cases, we still kind of bypass and use Selenium 1 driver, which is what is a Selenium backup there. Essentially, we have now moved over to the web driver.
Any questions? Yes, please.
Is it open source project?
We are planning to make it open source. We are still working on it. That's why we are making this complete framework is built on .NET. So we are transitioning to Java. Maybe in another 3 months' time or 4 months' time, we'll be making it open source. Yes.
How do you compare that with Source Labs? Because Source Labs are already have all the features that we already have.
Okay. So another thing which I wanted to point out is we are again partners with Source Labs. Our grid works with Source Lab. Their grid is something different. Ours is where we can distribute all over the cloud. So we can distribute our test cases over the Source Labs on demand, I think. So we can. Distribute our test cases over the cloud. So how different it is?
If you're using source infrastructure, we would end up using their grid.
Yeah.
We're not using our grid. But that grid is written for people who don't use source infrastructure. They have their own VM systems. And to drive that, we have the tag grid. So for instance, if somebody has 10 VMs, right, and you have the suite of 3,000 test cases, how to run, when to run,
manage that is what is
tagged. Yeah. But for Selenium, we would not be using the tagged as such.
Any other questions?
If I was to write some custom Selenium stuff, would I be able to put this in, or are you locked to your implementation Selenium?
I mean, for the moment, it locks to our implementation. Like, you'll have to let us know which enhancements need to be done, and we can make those enhancements. Maybe once it becomes open source, that would be possible.
But it would be easy because the main DL, the engine, is what needs to be extended. And we are already in the process of writing it into a critical engine and then engine which can be extended.
This requires Windows.
Yes, I mean, this executable, yes, it requires Windows.
So in your attacks, you can do this on run your attack system from a OSX box?
Yeah.
So this will run on Windows, but you could have a remote, we have an option of.
Yes.
So the client could be
required Windows too.
Yes. It requires Windows to be the main engine.
Any questions other than that? All right. Thank you guys.
Okay.